from K&M Photo and Video Services. Sorry about the waiting and for the live stream. We will have a little difficult on the road with accident, so the road was blocked, so it takes some time to clear. So sorry about that. So now we are doing the viewing of the body. The funeral service will not start as yet. So in the meantime, you're free to do so to subscribe. Leave your comments in the comment section. Alright guys, so remember, you can leave your comments in the comment section.
Thank you. Thank you.
guys, remember you're free to leave your comments in the comment section. Tune in. You can leave your name to see you're on the live stream. So you can leave your name.
Thank you. I know you as a friend. I have Could the congregation please stand?
Sojourner as all my fathers were. Oh, spare me that I may recover strength before I go hence and be no more. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God.
For I know that my Redeemer liveth, that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth, and I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself. With mine own eyes shall I behold him, not with another. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Indeed, we are happy to have you this morning as we meet on this occasion, on this side of Jordan. And we do encourage us that for the believer who dies in Christ, that this is not a bitter or sorrow experience, but is an experience of joy, because the angels in heaven will rejoice to know that one of their own is brought home to be with the Lord. At this time, we will turn to our hymnals, and we begin to sing the hymn, How Great Thou Art. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hand hath made, thy power throughout the universe displayed, then sings my soul the songwriter proclaim, my God, my Savior, to thee how great thou art. And I ask that we sing quite thusly as we do this one. After two, one, two.
Consider all the world.
because I believe this song is demonstrating a theological position that is great. A position that says that God is greater than your circumstances. That in creation, it shows the splendor, the magnificence of a God who exceeds your expectation and my expectation. And so we're going to sing it lustily. I know that I'm not a good singer, so if you can pitch it up fast and higher for me, I wouldn't mind. So let's go.
And when I sing that
and friends of Christmas. Father God, we know that we can do nothing without you. Our everything depends on you. And so, Father God, because of that, we give you thanks. We give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Just want to say that all of us know the reason why we are here. We are here to celebrate the life of Miss Joyce Williams. And before I take the lessons and any other item as outlined in your program, I just want on behalf of the elders, the ministerial committee of this church, the members and friends, to express our sincere sympathy to the family of Miss Joyce Williams. She is special to us here because those of us who might not have known her would have heard that while she was here, she gave her heart to the Lord and she was baptized here. And I was speaking with a member of the congregation now, and she remembered vividly when both of them used to attend church here. Over to you, Mrs. Green. Right. So she is a special. She's a part of grace. Although further on, she had left for a Pentecostal church. But that did not matter. Because what matters is the heart, not the denomination. Right, and we were glad to have her here. At this time, we are going to have our first lesson. And it's going to be read by Abigail Ford's granddaughter. And every person who is contributing to the program will speak from that podium. Thank you. 1 Corinthians 15, 50 to 58.
Good afternoon, everyone. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither do corruption inherit the corruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For the corruptible must be put in corruption, and this mortal must be put in mortality. So when this corruptible shall have put in corruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, the eternal last. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, also abounding in the word of the Lord. For as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, here in the portion of
God. All right, thanks, Abigail. We are now going to have a selection by Akilia Brown, and then Trudy Thompson, granddaughter, will come with the second lesson taken from John 14, 1 to 6. Akilia and then Trudy.
God is good, and all the time.
To thank Athelia and to Joyce
or to me for their participation in this service. I just wanted to point out that it's a common truth or a known truth that when we have debt, it brings together and pulls together persons, right? And sometimes we reflect and we go into a sort of historical situation where we are seeing things from genealogy and from history. And so this debt has brought to us the making of a community, how tight it can be. Because this lady has left Carla Clark, which is Val's daughter, as a member of this church. And we have with us Sister Corrie Overdeer, right, who is her niece, right. And then when we look over there, we have Brother Heat, right, New Testament Church of God. And of course, glad to see his wife, and she said, oh, we flew in for the funeral. Right, yes, and so you're saying, oh my, when is it going to stop? So it is so good to see everybody in one place and to know that the love, the care, the understanding that she had and that she shared is still with us. Yes, Sister Williams, you live on my dear. Right. We now reach where we are going to have our tributes, and they are coming in this order.
So much to me. I thought you were a part of my life. My aunt was a wonderful person and I loved her. She was my mother's older sister who shared a house with her mother, which was my grandmother. My earliest memories of her are etched prominently in my life. She was soft-spoken, kind-hearted, caring, loving, and held a strong Christian belief which guided the way she lived her daily life. I was her nephew, but I always felt that she loved me like her own son. The beauty, grace, love, and patience she possessed touched my heart in so many ways. Her strength and smile in London that days made me realize I had an aunt and a friend I could depend on. I don't think I've ever thanked my aunt enough for everything she has done for me. I want to thank her for believing in me, and I did not get it right at times. But through her encouragement, things turned out pretty well. I want to thank her for the love and care she delivered to her mother, my beloved grandma, in the last 6.5 years of her life. When I took the decision to move grandma from living in St. James, Aunt Joyce gladly accepted my plea to take her in her home. For this, I owe a debt of gratitude. Thank you for loving me unconditionally. Your memories will live through me. As a child, I remember comforting words when I thought I was wronged by my grandmother, who in my estimation at the time, would grant the punishment Lord just for us. I remember how proud she was when she saw my report card from Blackburn Primary School and Monroe College. and the tokens of love and appreciation she gave over those days. As I got older, my aunt always made an effort to stay involved in many aspects of my life. She was there at my first wedding and was one of the first people to offer words of congratulation and motherly advice when my daughter Tanya was born. I really appreciated how much she cared, and I knew I could always count on her for words of encouragement. I will forever salute you and Joyce because you have been there always to support and guide me through life. You taught me to never give up on my dreams, but to persevere no matter how hard the storms of life. Sweet memories fill me anytime I remember the advice from Pedro and Sharon on the occasions I sought your friends. You were always calm, even when the situation seemed unbearable. A trait I admire and which has become a guiding light in my own life up to this time. Aunt Joyce always worked hard, and I believe it is the reason why I chose you to raise my cousins as a single parent. I remember her being both dressmaker and hairdresser for some of the women in London, especially for occasions like weddings and other special occasions in those kind of events. When Aunt Joyce moved to New York almost 20 years ago, I kept in touch and visited her a couple of times. I last saw her in September 2019 and promised to visit her in the summer of 2020. Of course, COVID did not permit my visit. While waiting to make my visit, I got frequent updates on her situation and the health challenges she faced over the last couple of years through direct contact with Joyce. I was looking forward to making that long-promised trip this summer, but the Lord, who knows best, decided otherwise and called her home instead. I will miss my aunt's smile, positive attitude, words of encouragement, and advice. She was an incredible sister, mother, mother-in-law, friend, and aunt. She will be missed by a lot of people here today. I take solace in the fact that I know she's in a better place and she's free from sickness and pain. Aunt Joyce, I honor the path you have walked and the lessons you've shared from your journey through life. Your contribution to the family has left a lasting impression of love, caring, patience, gratitude, and humility. Know that you'll never be forgotten and will always be loved by all of us in the family. In this tribute, I'd like to read a poem. It's called What My Aunt Meant to Me. It's by an author unknown and it's modified in some ways. Aunts have no wants or wings, so they work with wisdom, love, and peace. Having taken on this role, you loved me right down to my soul. You offered kindness and greetings with a hug and kiss, each freely out of love, which I will miss. I choose a twinkling star in the sky at night to serve prayer for you, so it's bright light. You are in God's heaven now, and no longer in pain. In my thoughts, you will always remain. How lucky I was. How blessed I have been. You are my aunt. You are more than my aunt. You are also my friend. I'll miss you, Aunt Joyce. I wish you eternal peace and will always love you. Until we meet again, so long, dear Aunt Joyce.
Remembering home. don't think of her this way. Instead, remember the good times you had, or the funny things she'd say. Remember her in the good times, how she loved the fragrant breeze. Remember her in summer, as the sunshine kissed her cheeks. Remember her in autumn, how she loved the turning leaves. Remember her in winter, watching snowflakes drift in the breeze. But although Mama surely loved these things, remember she loved you all more. And don't lose heart, because we'll see her again when we all reach that distant shore.
As a young child, was when you would come to me and say, "Perry, you want to know about what I'm supposed to do? Should I give myself?" So I could always come to her and my little daughter, and she would get a book. And we end our conversation crying. I had planned right after that visited her. But I never knew it. Mom, I feel so sorry.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'm not one.
gift that we have received. Let us all. Heavenly Father, we are indeed grateful for today. We are thankful, Lord, for the blessings that you have bestowed on your people. God, as we receive it with thanksgiving. Mighty Father, may you sanctify it with your own word. God, may we use Almighty God to the development and the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. For those of us who might not have known our lot, not to fasten our business, but have not known a lot about our dear sister, we are now going to hear, and we are going to hear it through the eulogy, right? And this will be presented to us by George Thompson, her son-in-law. And I know that he's going to say this is the best mother-in-law on earth. So let me appreciate it. All right, Mr. Thompson.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good afternoon, sir. We are here this morning to celebrate the life of Joyce Agatha Billings. I take the liberty this morning to say her middle name, because in life, we have to say that from a distance. And you evoke a cold stare that sends chills down your spine. I don't know why she came in that name, but my theory is that if you have been through the Jamaican public school system, you know your peers love to call names. So a beautiful name like Agatha will be reduced to Gata. Joyce Williams was born in Germantown, St. James, on February 14, 1934. A Valentine's Day present for Father Richard Williams and Mother Iona Hunter. She was the second of three children, the first predeceased her as a toddler, and the remaining younger sister is Phyllis. Miss Joyce attended the Bonsfield All Age School, and upon completion, she was sent to Kingston to her own link. While there, she worked in a hattery, making beautiful hats. At age 18, she went to live with her mother in Black River, present address. In Black River, she learned dressmaking, and her dressmaking skills were exemplary, as she paid great attention to detail. If you bought any garment for her, she'd pick it apart. The sleeve is not right. This wasn't any problem. That's the kind of lady she was. As a child, at our young age, she was very quiet and reserved, but would try to get across her. She had her sister, Phyllis, at her back. Miss Joyce bore five children: Linda, otherwise known as Val, who predeceased her; Sharon, that's my wife, otherwise called Grace; Roxanne, otherwise called Jeannie; Colin, affectionately known as Freddie; and Judith,
the beautiful daughter. The five children she had gave her 17 grandchildren, 15 great grand, and one great great grand. Miss Joyce was a single mother who sacrificed to give her children the best nurturing and an education in spite of the circumstances. They have now blossomed into responsible professional adults. Ms. Joyce was also the caregiver of her ailing mother up to her passing. She migrated to the United States soon after, where she continued the nurturing cycle of assisting in the care of her grandchildren. Her time was spent vacillating between Florida, New York, and Jamaica. Grandma was a Christian woman who fellowshipped, as he said for, in this church and in the Pentecostal church. She also could be found reading her Bible and praying on a daily basis. She was also very critical of how you dress. So this is too worldly. This is not appropriate. But that's a woman she was. She also liked to do crossword puzzles and word games. She liked to cook. And I certainly enjoyed her cooking. She also liked to watch a juicy soap opera. She had one of the best penmanship we could find. And when I acknowledge that, you'd see her give a deep, broad smile. I also called her Teach. And of course, teaching was one of her unfulfilled passions. In the latter years, her health began to fail, and frequent trips between home, the hospital, and the nursing home were the norm. Her wish to return to Jamaica was not realized, as she gave up the fight prematurely. She sadly left us on May 27, 2022, to be with the Lord. While she might not be with us, her spirit remained in our heart. The lovely smile, the tasty dishes, the warm hugs. That's how we remember Ms. Joyce. So she is now with our Heavenly Father. No more pain, no more suffering, and no more heartache. May her soul rest in your eternal bliss. Goodbye, Ms. Williams. Goodbye, Joyce. Goodbye, Aunt Joyce. Goodbye, Mama. Goodbye, Grandma.
It's not very, very big, but I can say that good food has added to that.
Miss Joyce, Miss Joyce's cooking, right? Yes, beautiful lady, right? Everybody that you speak to, of course, we are human beings and we have our shortcomings, but that lady has done a world of good during her time. So let us celebrate her life. Continue to celebrate her life in fine style. At this time, we are going to have a selection from Miss Brown. She was especially invited from Pentecostal Church, Holiness Church, right? So, you know, it gives some balance here, all right?
Thank you.
what a beautiful voice. And so I'm going to keep my voice down. Because you have set the tone. And the mood is here. We are all relaxed. And we are anticipating the word from God through His ordained speaker. So may we just put ourselves at a place where we can hear from Miss Williams Kiana. So she has left her testimony and she has left someone to pass on the word. The next voice you hear will be that of Elder Bennett, a product of this church, and now he's here ministering on to us. Let us sit back, relax, listen.
Amen. Give God thanks. God is a good God. He has been faithful. His strength is on what we rely. And in times like these, I tell you, it is an emotional time that tends to put us in a place where we wonder what next. Thanks. So let us turn to the word of God on which we rely for strength. Jeremiah chapter 31 verse 29 reads as follows. In those days they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. But everyone shall die for his own iniquity, and every man shall eat the sour grapes, his teeth shall set on edge. Let us pray. Eternal, most righteous Heavenly Father, we give you thanks. We praise your name. We declare you to be God. And at this time, we say, remove your manservant, replace him with your very own self, recognizing, Lord, that it is your anointing that makes a difference over our lives. We give you thanks now in Jesus' name. Amen. The word of the Lord from Jeremiah was a word that got Jeremiah into trouble. In fact, this very message that he spoke to the people, he was sent in prison, set upon to die. He was thrown in a pit, and someone had to make clothes and grab him and pull him out of that pit. It's a very serious and challenging word. Because the word suggests to you and I that your faith is doomed to destruction based on the things of the past. And so many of us feel trapped in the body that we now have or the circumstances to which we find ourselves. You and I often say that there is nothing we can do. Have you ever reached that point that you say, boy, I just give up because this thing is going to happen no matter what? Have you ever been so crushed by situations that you are going to say to yourself, there is no hope. There is nothing that no one can do. There is nothing that I can do to stop what is going to happen. And we read in this particular text that Jeremiah was speaking to the people of Israel when they were sieged by what was known as a powerful empire called the Babylonian Empire. They had taken
siege all around. They had conquered every single nation that was around, and there was no hope. In fact, the Lord said to Jeremiah, go and tell the people, say, go on, surrender. Don't even lift up a hand to fight, because you're going to die if you do so. Have you ever been in a situation where there's nothing you can do, and every single one that comes your way tells you that it's gonna be alright, but it's going to happen? There are moments like that in many persons' life. I suggest to you that this world itself is in this situation. We are caught between what it is and set of looming crises. The world, we have seen where they have crises. We are now seeing economic crises out of proportion, and in as humanity exists, there is no way out of getting away from the high prices at the supermarket. There's no way around you going in there and spending less this week than you spent last week. Every day it's getting out of hand, and you say that your faith is doomed. There's nothing you can do. You take all that money. I said, I just have to spend it. God, that is what it is. Have you ever been in a situation where you are somehow set that there's nothing you can do? You feel powerless. You feel empty. You feel void. But some men, and I have seen, that they wonder, when and how did I get trapped in this relationship? And I have one, then two, then three, then four, then five. And I can't understand why my life is sealed to the faith to which I now find myself in. This was what was happening in the day. There was no hope. There was no solution to the problem that they were facing. It was death, destruction, and nothing could stop it. Worst of all, God came and said to them that you're going to die if you fight this one. So, that must have been a rough time. Truth is, we have been to situations close to that, but probably most of us have never been there. That when we look at it, it is life or death, and we see it in our face. We can taste death. We can taste disappointment. There's nothing that is going to change that situation. You feel helpless. You feel doomed. I know what would be worse. If that situation was caused by someone else. Brothers and sisters, remember when you go out and you never really want to go, but your bigger brother or friend influenced you to stay out a little bit longer. And you're going home knowing that punishment is here, beating is here, and you know that it is not you who do it, as somebody else, and you feel even worse because you were not the source of it, but it just happened to you. And every time you see the person, you remember saying, them. Maybe you were good behavior. I may have been a disappointment to my parents one or two times. I suggest to you and I that this world is in a similar situation where there is a pending doom, there is pending destruction, and there is nothing you and I can do about it. You know, one of the things about life is this. Hebrews 9 verse 27 says this, that it is appointed unto man once to die. And so many of us in here, we feel that strong, don't you? We feel like we could run a mile at times. But don't you know that your death appointment is one of those things that you can't do anything about it? You can't change it. You can't delay it. You can't send your child to God and say, God, answer, I am not here for it. There is also something else that is out there that you need to understand. Perhaps you may live and not die, but don't you know that Jesus is coming and you can't do nothing about it? Don't you know that one day he's going to burst the clouds asunder and the dead in Christ shall rise, and then those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet him in the sky, and so we shall be for all eternity? Don't you understand that you can't change it? Don't you understand that you can't do nothing about it? In fact, the disciples asked Jesus, when he was being ascended, when will be the times and the season? And Jesus answered and said, it is not for you to know the time and the seasons that God has appointed in this time. Don't you know you can't change God's plan? Don't you know that things sometimes can happen and you can't do nothing about it? For many of us, we live as if we are the superstars, the one who we must see, the big headline act on the show, and that in the end is about me, me, and more me. And we don't realize that our faith, you're going to die. And if perchance the Lord comes before you die, then you're going to face him. Don't you understand that the Bible says that every man, woman, and child will have to present themselves before the God of all ages? And that one day you and I must give ourselves and come before the maker of the universe, the one who sees all, who is in all, through all, yet he is above all things. You can't do nothing about it. You're going to have to accept it. The Bible declares that those who have not yet trusted, those who have not accepted as Lord and Savior. In fact, Matthew chapter 7 declares that many will say, Lord, Lord, didn't we do this? Didn't we come to church today and put in a good offering? Didn't we help the sick? Didn't we care for those who were suffering? Didn't we live a good life? Wasn't my conduct great? I was never yet arrested by the police. I was never yet accused to be a thief. But we'll hear on that judgment day, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. I have no part and share with you. Because your faith is cast. You can't change. You and I must realize that unless we trust God, we will die and go to hell. St. John chapter 3 and verse 17 and 18 says this. I know what you want to say. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. Very good, but have everlasting life. But the verse after that says that if you don't believe in Jesus Christ, you have already stood condemned. I'm told that especially in the 80s, in Jamaica, there was a section in the general penitentiary that is called the condemned section. A section where once you are in that block, you know that you will die. One day you are going to die and you can't do nothing about it. You hope that the courts would somehow rule and give you a chance. But every day you wake up in that cell, you know that death has been appointed. Some of us living in condemned cells call our body
and we don't know it. We don't understand it. We don't appreciate it. You and I must realize that God will bring every man, every woman into account. In fact, the text we read says, everyone shall die of his own iniquity. When you die, you can't go to God and say, boy, and the man will be there with woman release me and become married. And the man and the woman there, and them hold me down, and the church people them, we're over there, so we're bad mind, we are walk over here, and all these things, they kept me away from you, God. And it is that that woman who disrespected me, and I now go back to that church there, no more. It is them, Lord, who stopped me. I'm sure God will punish every Christian who blocks someone, but I tell you the truth, that there is a reward coming for you. There is something coming out, because the Bible says the wages of sin, the payment for sin, is going to be death, death, death. We make no quarrels. We make no sympathy. I'm telling you this very truth, that whoever does not believe in Jesus Christ, you will die in your sin and go to hell. It is real. So, is your faith cast? Is your life so set that there is nothing you can do about it? There are many things that I can't change. I wish I was 20 years old, younger, sorry. I wish, like my sister there, I know that you wish with the greatest of respect that you could throw away that stick today and walk and lift those hands and jump up high, because there's coming a day for many young persons that they say the grinders will become few, the eyes become dim, and the strong man's back will be bent. Oh God, if you understand that there's coming a day that we can't do nothing about it. But why? Don't we make that choice today to make that change? So when that certainty comes called death, when that certainty comes called judgment, that I, and I'm a big chest, but I stand boldly, knowing that I am covered with the robe of righteousness that Jesus gives to me. And the Bible and the Psalm says, oh, what joy is this to know my heavenly Father loved me so. He gives to me my Jesus, because when he looks at me, he sees not what I used to be, but he now sees Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Can I tell you something? It's a blessed thought to know that me, simple me, can pass God's righteous test to go into heaven. Sinful me, wicked me, lustful thought me, somehow who should have been dying and condemned because of the death of Jesus Christ, because of the cross of Jesus Christ, I now find liberty and peace, and I have been now reconciled to God. I've been washed with the water of regeneration, and his word now cleansed me, and I'm now being made pure to enter into the holies of holies to see my God. What a blessed thought. And then I will walk on those streets, those pearly streets of heaven, and I will see the angels, and I see Peter, I see John, and I see all the patriarchs of the Bible, and then look at David, I see all the righteous, I see Jeremiah, I see Isaac, I see Moses, I see all these people. But most of all, I now see Jesus. Hallelujah. I see him in his majesty, clothed in righteousness, sitting on his throne, looking down on earth, and say, whoa, unto the rest of these people who rejected me. I say to you that we can accept the offer that God gives and reject the sealed faith that we are heading to if we don't accept Jesus Christ. We can change what is going to happen to our human existence. You and I can make it right before a God who is looking, waiting, anxiously, waiting for you, waiting for me to surrender. He has his ear bent down on his face, his eyes zooming, looking down on you. He's just waiting with expectation that that great father was able to see his son coming. And he says, he runs to that son, he hugs him, he kisses him, he places a ring on his finger, and he says, give the party, make heaven rejoice, let there be joy, let there be peace. Oh, that God could say that to be about you. Oh, that heaven could run and meet you today and kiss you. Put a ring on your finger. Say to you, let's keep the party up there. Let's have the real joy up there. Not like Belshazzar, who was having the party and defying the things of God. And call for the holy things of God and touch with it. And the writing came on the wall and said, me, you for take care, you fasting. Meaning that you have been weighed, measured, and found wanting. Can I tell you, in closing, that you don't have to accept the certain faith that you are heading to by accepting Jesus Christ? You see, there was this woman. Jesus interacted with this woman, said to the woman at the well, woman, go on to your husband, you all right? He said, well, I didn't have no money. Jesus said, you're right, because you have five already. The one that you meet is not your own. And when Jesus interacted with this woman, she left that strange and she ran into the town and called everybody that would listen to her and said, come see a man who told me all about my condition. And the people that were so surprised, they run come and come look and say, we believe. Not because you tell us, but because we have come to know and see Jesus for ourselves. Don't let nobody tell you about God. I want you to experience him in the fullness today. That you people will understand. The Bible says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. I encourage you today. You are not a Christian. I do this at every funeral that people come at times. Some reject. But if you are here today and you are not a Christian, I'm asking you to change over your life and surrender to Jesus Christ right here, right now. Don't accept the faith that you're heading to. Change it today, right now, and accept Jesus Christ. Are you here today? You're not a Christian. You're right with God. You know that. No question asked. This is your moment. This is your time. If you want to accept Jesus Christ, and I'm asking all persons to reason with God for yourself. Stand up and feel one foot. And understand, say, boy, are you on God now? If you're not a Christian and you want to be saved today, raise that hand for Jesus Christ. We give him the offer once, twice, three times. Your faith has been left to what you believe. I suggest to you that this word will form part of the evidence that God will now say to you, what did you do on the 24th of June when this message was spoken to you? What did you say about it? Move from in front of me. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that you are a good God, that your word declares, we believe it to be true, that your word will never return to you void, but it will accomplish that which it has said to be accomplished. that your word is powerful, it is effective, it's a discerner of the thoughts of man. It's able to detach the joints from the marrow. So Lord, we say to you that your word has spoken, and Lord, it will bear fruit in due season. Thank you for everyone that is here. May Lord, we all get it right in the sight of God. Amen. Oh, what a beautiful message.
Yes. Suited for the occasion and suited for the times. We are coming down now. We are going to head to our burial. But before that, we have a few items. We have the prayer for the bereaved, the family. We have instructions, and so we are going to, and then we are going to have our recessional hymns. At this time, I'm going to ask the congregation to stand, excepting the family members. Family members, sit, and all others, I'm going to ask you to. I'm going to ask
Elder
to pray for
you and
the family.
Let us pray. Lord, in times of grief, times of sorrow, when we need solace, when we need rest, when we need your comfort, Lord, your word says, blessed are they who mourn, for they, Lord, shall be comforted. Lord, we know that weeping may endure for a season, but hallelujah, joy cometh in the morning. Lord, we know, Lord, that death brings with it a sting. Grave brings with it a sorrow. But Lord, we know that those who die in Christ have comfort. Comfort, Lord, that no one will ever precede them going to heaven, as Thessalonians reminds us. But we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Lord, we are confident that your daughter, Sister Williams, is going to be with the Lord. And so, Lord, we pray that family members will find comfort with that. And Lord, that your peace, which passes all understanding, transcends our ability to think, or even to expect, that your peace will be with them. You said in your word, my peace give I unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. So Lord, we pray that you comfort their hearts. Lord, emotionally we may become unstable from time to time. But we realize, Lord, that this is your doing, and what the Lord has done has been well done. Help us to take comfort in these words. Reassure the hearts of family members of the good times that they had. Comfort them with the joys, the memories, the moments, the seasons and the times. And to know, Lord, that they have this assurance that once they are ready, they'll meet her in the end. We are thanking you, Lord, that you can sustain them over the next moments, that empty space in the room will be certainly missed. Lord, every time you take up that album, you look at a picture, every time the birthdays, the Mother's Day, and all the special occasions come about, we will remember we have lost someone who is dear to us. But give them that solace, that peace, that we'll be able to carry them through. As the songwriter says, his blood will carry me all the way. We give you thanks, O Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We all say, amen.
Alright, we are going to have the reception up here. And after singing the first verse and the refrain, the pallbearers, they are going to proceed outside with the body. And then members of the family will follow, right? And after the clergy party, and then right, members of the immediate family, and then the other persons will follow. We want it to be orderly. This is the best that we can do for Sister Williams. So we want it to be orderly. Now that has to do with the procession. We know that we are going to the Longwood Cemetery. At the back of your program, of course, you would have had your acknowledgement. So the family of our beloved Joyce Williams extended to you our deepest heartfelt, sincere thanks and appreciation for the love shown to our moments of sadness and grief as we mourn her passing. Your cards, gifts, visits, prayers, phone calls, donations, support, words of encouragement and comfort have been the strength to make it this far. May the Lord God bless and keep you always. And this, of course, is coming from the Williams' family. So although it is there, they want it to be loud and clear. All right? And when we reach, my brothers and sisters and friends, to the graveside, it's the continuation of the church service. So I'm going to ask that as much as possible, we participate. After her body is down and everything is done, then we can break out in our groups and greet whoever we want to greet. I am assigning Aunt Merle's tribe, who are here, yes, to indicate where the repast will be. It's right over by Gabby's place when everything is said and done. Let us stand for the recessional hymn. What a fellowship.
What a fellowship.
What a joy divine.
Blessed is
Let's hear the chorus. Say the chorus one more time. Yes,
alright guys, on the live stream, thank you guys for watching. We are now heading to the graveside, so I'm not going to end the stream, I'm going to keep the live stream to the graveside. So we're going to do a little motorcade from the church now to the graveside, so keep tuning on the live stream, thank you. All right, everybody on the live stream, so remember, I'm not going to end the stream. We are heading to the graveside now, so keep tuning on the live stream. For me, please and thanks. You are hearing from KNM Photo and Video Services. Thank you. Funeral service by Jones and Fairweather. Everybody on the live stream, we're heading to the graveside, so keep tuning on the link and remember, please to subscribe to the channel and turn on your post notification bell so you'll be notified whenever I upload the edited funeral service. You can see the full editing quality. Thank you. So remember, if you don't subscribe, you cannot see the full video that is edited. You have to subscribe, so whenever I post it, you will be notified.
Hold up, bad boy, hold up. Let me camp us here. Not too close. Go on, cuz.
Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The Lord of the Lord is our refuge. Selah.
Father, we thank you tonight because we see your goodness.
I love you, Lord.
The gang one, come on, somebody black you.
For your mercy never failed me. Oh, my God, you've been held in your name. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Alright guys, so we are heading to the gravesite. As you can see, we are doing a little motorcade from the church.
Hi, I'm Evangelist Maxine Duncan, and you are listening to Messenger Prince.
The road is a little bit rocky, so as you can see, a little shaking. Don't wait for miracles.
Jesus.
It is a little bit rocky, people. As you can see, very shaking. The road is rough. So, and I have sitting in the back of the bus also. So sorry about the shaking of the video.
Boy, I need to say hi, boy. Where's the shepherd? Cemetery? Where grab this? Where are you?
Thank you.
Sorry, please.
All right, as you said, we're doing a very brief viewing. Comfort in the 23rd Psalm. It says that the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The psalmist writes, hear my cry, O Lord, give ear unto my prayer. Hold thy peace at my tears, for I am a stranger with thee, a sojourner, as all my fathers were. O spare me, that I will recover strength before I go henceforth and be no more. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or even thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting unto everlasting, thou art God. For a thousand years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as the watch in the night. They are as asleep in the morning. They are like grass which groweth up, and in the evening is cut down. So teach me, O Lord, to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. The psalmist also declares in Psalm 116 that blessed in his sight are the souls of the departed. And so today we are here to commit our dearly beloved sister Joyce Williams to the Lord. We therefore commit her body to the ground, because it is from the earth we shall return. Job response to his calamity was made. Job responds, I know that my Redeemer liveth, and he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth, and I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself with mine own eyes. Shall I behold him and not with another? We now commit the body of our dearly beloved sister Joyce to the ground. And we say, earth, earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust. To the earth we shall return, all of us. Therefore, I encourage each and every one of us to make sure that our calling and our election is made sure. No one knows the hour, no one knows the time. The Bible declares that it's appointed unto man once to die, but after the death of man comes the judgment. And we encourage each of any one of us who are here that we better get right with God. Come and do it now. Under the cross of Jesus, I lay my burden down. We better get right with God. We turn, we just pray as we commit our dearly beloved sister Joyce to the Lord. Eternal Father, we pray that you, O God, with your everlasting arms, will receive the soul of our dearly beloved sister Joyce as she waits for that moment when the trump of God shall sound and the dead in Christ shall rise. And so, Lord, we pray that you'll cover her even now. Comfort those of us who are here, because we do not mourn as those who do not have hope. Because the Bible declares that if it is in this life we have hope, we of all men should be most pitied. And so, Lord, we commit our body now to you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Shall we turn and sing this hymn? When the roll is called up yonder. When the roll is called up yonder. It's on your program. We're going to move quickly. We're going to ask the gentlemen to come quickly and begin the mixing process. Rain is upon us. We do not have the luxury of time. So let's go, let us sing, and lastly, to encourage them as they work fast. When the roll is called up yonder, and
when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more. And the morning
let's pick it up a little faster.
And bright and fair.
Over on the other side.
And the road is all up yonder.
Let's hear the chorus, everyone knows it.
When the road
bright and proud this morning when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his.
All right, guys, thank you for watching the live stream. So remember to please subscribe so you'll be notified when the full service is uploaded. Thank you.
I don't think you know.
I'm going to end the stream because rain is dropping and you know the camera is hot from morning, so it's not supposed to be getting wet. So thank you guys for watching. Remember to subscribe so you can get the full edited video by Monday latest. Thank you.
Let us labor.